Hello and welcome. My name is Lauren Minsky, and I'm on the history faculty at New York University Abu Dhabi. It's my great pleasure to warmly welcome you to the talk today and to introduce you to our very distinguished speaker. Today's Institute talk is an installment in the New York University Abu Dhabi History Program's ongoing lecture series entitled How to Write Global Histories. My colleagues and I selected this as our central theme this year because of its significance at the present moment for our historical profession. That is, how we as historians conduct our research, design our curriculums, and teach courses to our undergraduates, and more generally, for how we all, as global citizens in the 21st century, understand and tell stories about our collective human past. We would like to extend our sincere thanks to the New York University Abu Dhabi Institute for generously supporting this series. The last few decades has witnessed a major shift towards global approaches to the study of history. It's now fairly routine for historians to be centrally concerned with studying human connections and processes that link far-flung parts of the world, and to work towards understanding the transformative nature of these trans-regional or global connections. But nevertheless, it still remains challenging for historians to fundamentally alter important facets of the way in which history is studied. In no small part, this is because the conventional spaces within which historians have long worked, and by these I mean primarily spaces of civilizations, nation states, and post-World War II area studies, such as the Middle East, Africa, South Asia, East Asia, et cetera, have become so deeply institutionalized in the organization of universities and knowledge production around the world, including archives, academic conferences, funding programs, et cetera. And this has led to a certain fragmentation of historians' everyday work into nationally and area-specific enclaves. And at larger universities, these enclaves even operate in relative isolation from one another often. It's also typical for universities to focus quite heavily on the history of the particular nation state or Cold War area in which they are located, not infrequently marginalizing or outright ignoring other world areas as a result. So it's in this context that the history program at New York University Abu Dhabi has been trying to make the most of the tremendous opportunities that arise when you're building a university and its curriculum from scratch. We have wanted to really rethink what a global history program for the 21st century and its globally minded citizens might look like, what it should look like. And there are three features that especially distinguish our collective efforts so far. First, we've made a commitment to covering all of the regions of the world in as egalitarian a manner as possible. Second, we've chosen to organize our curriculum around ocean systems, the Pacific, Atlantic, Mediterranean, and Indian Oceans, so as to teach our students to think about the spaces of history in complicated ways that cut across and around the conventional spaces of civilizations, nations, and Cold War areas. We want our students to be able to see and learn how to make sense of the shifting densities of connections that people have created in the realms of trade and economics, politics, religion, culture, science and medicine, and the environment, among many others. We also want our students to appreciate the historical contingency of any given historical space and density of interconnections, rather than treating areas ahistorically from ancient times to the present. And third, lastly, we hope for our students to develop an appreciation for the importance of studying history at different spatial and temporal scales, from the local to the regional to the global, from short to the long durée, and a facility with moving among different scales in their coursework and research projects. Our modest efforts here have been very preliminary, but they are ones that frankly would not have been possible for us to imagine without the long-term pioneering work that has been done by our speaker for this evening, Professor Patrick Manning. And so it is truly an enormous honor and a special pleasure for us to welcome Professor Manning, the Andrew W. Mellon Professor of World History at the University of Pittsburgh and Director of the University of Pittsburgh's World History Center. Professor Manning was originally educated as an undergraduate in chemistry at the California Institute of Technology, and it was following this that he trained in history and economics at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, where he ultimately received a PhD in history. To begin, he specialized in the economic history of Africa, but over the course of his career, he steadily became a specialist in world history overall. His research and his many publications have focused on such topics as demographic history, particularly of the African slave trade, the social and cultural history of Francophone Africa, global migration, African diaspora as a dimension of global history, and various overviews of the field of world history. In addition to his work directing the World History Center at the University of Pittsburgh, he also currently serves as the president of the World History Network Incorporated. And this is a nonprofit corporation that does important work fostering research and international exchange in world history. Throughout his distinguished career, Professor Manning has been one of the major advocates for and innovators of the field of global history, at the forefront, really, of bringing this field into the historical mainstream around the world and of pioneering new approaches to its study and teaching. His particular contributions in this regard are honestly too many to fully describe here, so I just want to very briefly share two highlights of his current efforts, both of which he is generously sharing with us during his time in Abu Dhabi. First, Professor Manning is currently at work directing CHIA, or the Collaborative for Historical Information and Analysis, which is an initiative to create a world historical data resource. Professor Manning argues that in order to make plans and develop policy for the huge future of human society at the global level, it is necessary to have coherent information on the global past of human society. And we currently lack sufficient data sets in this regard. So Professor Manning is leading a highly interdisciplinary and highly collaborative effort across the social sciences to create and maintain historical data sets from local to global levels, from short to long term, linking variables on many aspects of human experience, including social, cultural, health, and climate issues worldwide for the past 400 years. And if you're interested in learning more about this quite revolutionary initiative, Professor Manning recently published a book entitled Big Data and World History, a World Historical Archive in 2013. And he will also be speaking about this project in the History Program's research seminar this Tuesday from 5:30 to 7:30 at New York University Abu Dhabi's downtown campus, to which you are all warmly invited to join. Second, Professor Manning's work has long been at the forefront of highly interdisciplinary efforts to understand the significance of human migrations and diasporas in shaping world history. He has a number of major publications stemming from this work, including The African Diaspora, A History Through Culture in 2009, a co-edited volume on migration history and world history, Multidisciplinary Approaches in 2010, and a co-authored book on migration and world history in 2012. It's especially notable that in studying migration and the creation of diasporas, Professor Manning purposely refuses to divide them into the experiences of separate regions and nations. So, for instance, in his work on the African diaspora, he's followed the multiple routes that brought Africans and people of African descent into contact with one another throughout the world. He has specifically shown, and I think you will see where our program draws some inspiration in his work, quote, how the waters of the Atlantic Ocean, the Mediterranean Sea, and the Indian Ocean fueled dynamic interactions among Black communities and cultures, and how these patterns resembled those of a number of connected diasporas concurrently taking shape across the globe. We are truly thrilled that it is from his work on African diaspora and world history that Professor Manning will speak to us tonight with a talk entitled A Global History of the African Diaspora. Will you please join me in very warmly welcoming Professor Manning?
Good evening. Thank you, Lauren Minsky, for an introduction one would wish for. It's a great pleasure to be here. So there's the title. We have the logo for the World History Center. I'm pleased to have it around. So just to repeat a little bit of the summation that was just given to you, my research focused for a good while on the on slave trade from and within Africa and the effects of that whole social system on the size of African population. And I've argued that indeed the population of the African continent was restricted and decreased in large parts of the continent from the 18th to the 19th century, just as a result of the losses to slave trade. But this story and tracing the people who were enslaved off to their different directions led me to studies of the African diaspora overall. And it's the basis of the book that I did on the African diaspora, published in 2009. And I called it a history through culture because the problems for the early days that one works on are that we don't have as many written records from people in Africa and of African descent as other places, but we do have the material culture and the expressive culture of just the forms of food and dress and music. It gave expression of the people in the African continent and in the diaspora of their ideas, their opinions, their responses to the world in which they live. And in the course of that work, I, though trained in work on West Africa and on the Atlantic, became particularly interested in the size of the African migration to North Africa and to the Middle East and to the Old World generally, and to the interesting patterns that need to be put on an equal basis at the level of interpretation, if not for the size of the population that moved, with the larger diaspora moving from Africa to the New World. So here's the map that I offer to categorize dimensions of the African diaspora. So I begin with the Sub-Saharan African homeland as the place where people who, much as they differ from one another in so many ways, have been classified as black people, people of color, for the last several centuries of their interaction with people elsewhere in the world. And then as the slave trade developed, there was a distinction between the Sub-Saharan homeland and the, what I've called the offshore areas, literally offshore in islands of the Atlantic or the Indian Ocean, and figuratively offshore in the great sea of the Sahara, where so many people lived out their lives working on date plantations and salt mines and so forth. Then, and here's the, I suppose, innovation, in any case, reconfiguring the terminology that I came up with to identify the near diaspora, the regions of North Africa, the Arabian Peninsula, and Madagascar, where large numbers of people came from Sub-Saharan Africa in slavery for really quite long periods of time. And then beyond that, the far diaspora of Europe and South Asia and Central Asia, and the other far diaspora of the Americas. So I range back and forth amongst these different regions within this framework. A couple other introductory points that people of Sub-Saharan African descent are roughly a sixth, maybe a seventh, of the total population of the world now. And that percentage has gone up and down over time, but over a long time, it's been pretty dependably like that. So a whole billion people are living on the African continent altogether. A population in the New World diaspora that is roughly three times as large as that of people of African descent in the Old World. And a total, which is a large proportion of the total of humanity, too large a proportion to be ignored in the way the continent is in too many areas of discussion. Here's another way of comparing Africa and its place in the world with an equal area projection of the Eastern Hemisphere, in which you can see that the African continent is about half the size of Eurasia. Actually, it's 55% of the size of Eurasia. And the lines that I've drawn there suggest different ways of drawing the line between Africa and Eurasia. The heavy line, the one that follows the Mediterranean and the Red Sea, is the most obvious continental distinction. But on the other hand, the line below that, which goes south of the Sahara and kind of across the Somali desert, is where you might draw the line in racial terms, or more precisely, color terms. And you can also draw another line further to the north that would include the Iberian Peninsula and Arabia along with Africa in terms of the ecology of the region. That makes sense. Also in terms of really the days of the establishment of the Islamic community, when everything from Iberia to Arabia were under Islamic domination. So we'll come back to looking at these different ways of fitting where Africa fits in. Oh, let me make one more point about population. So for contemporary figures, for figures today, the African population is less dense than that in Eurasia, of course, but maybe not as much less dense as you would think. That is to say that as a crude calculation for the population per square kilometer for the African continent, it's about 40% of that for Eurasia. For all the immense concentration of population in India and China, for Eurasia as a whole, it's 2.5 times denser than Africa. So there's still a lot of people on the African continent. One more look at framework here. On the left, I've given an ecological map that reminds you that the ecology, the climate and vegetation of West and Central Africa, where so many people came from on their way to the Americas, that ecology fits rather neatly with the ecology of Northern South America and the Caribbean. On the other map that I've shown here is has a bunch of dots on it, which are places referred to in my African Diaspora book that were north and east of Sub-Saharan Africa. And it's just to show a fairly even collection of places that are in the discussion where people of African origin entered into the historical record and then into my book. Of course, some people went further than that. Japanese sailors on Portuguese ships getting all the way to Japan and so forth, but those numbers are small. Now I'm going for most of the rest of the talk to do a narrative, period by period, of the development of the African diaspora as a whole, and then more and more focusing particularly on the North African Middle East region. In each case, I'll start the period off with some upbeat points, and then the period will end up with a problem that preoccupies people in the next period after that. So here we go, looking at the connections of the African continent within the continent and with the rest of the world for times before 1600. To emphasize that mobility in Africa and in the old world as a whole can be traced back very far indeed. And the other emphasis that I'm giving here is to identify some particular historic roles that showed up in the course of the formation of the African diaspora. So I've got two of them here, the one to the right is that of motherhood. Well, motherhood is with us wherever we go, but it's been particularly emphasized in African societies. And this sculpture from Nigeria does it with a little extra emphasis. So you can see the child in the lap of the mother. If you look carefully, then you can see the second child, which with feet placed on her shoulders and behind her head. One other point that makes this a special group is that the small child in the lap of the mother has adult breasts. So but anyhow, it's an imaginative piece of thinking that I think represents a continuing thread. The other thread that's represented here is that of performers. Drums are important in the music of West and Central Africa, and a study of the distribution of drums throughout the region makes clear that they go back thousands of years, that the various types of drums have been traced back and forth, have been exchanged, I mean to say, back and forth across West and Central Africa, and now, of course, have spread to all the world. And here are some references to the early voyages of Africans. Camels showed up as dependable sources of transport something over 2,000 years ago. The middle image there centers on a mosque of the West African Sahel, and might remind you of the famous pilgrimage of Mansa Musa, the Sultan of the Empire of Mali, who traveled with a huge group of followers to Mecca in the pilgrimage in 1324. And finally, we have some Sierra Leonean oarsmen moving along in a 19th, early 20th century image. Now, what I want to emphasize with this image is partly just a reminder of the geography, the vegetation of the African continent, which is split neatly in north-south terms by the equator, so with a forest across the middle of it, and then deserts at either end of it, and a small section of Mediterranean climate at the north and the south. But the point I'm emphasizing, particularly with the term the African web, is that this continent was traversed in every direction by people, ideas, and material culture. It's not so much that of great highways, such a thing as the Silk Road, that great highway of commerce from the west to the east end of the Asian mainland, but of smaller paths crossed in multiple directions. And in the book, I try to show how things like musical instruments, types of crops, and ideas have moved from one part of the continent to another part of the continent in all sorts of directions. So again, emphasizing that migration was something built way into the long term of African life. Here's an image from just a little over 2,000 years ago that was unearthed in Nîmes in southern France, a beautiful Roman era sculpture of a boy who's a performer. There's what is probably a flute that's been lost here, just a hint of a look at interconnections long ago. Now I'll slip to a period that's only 1,000 years ago and talk about the 150-year-long period of religious wars along the fringe between Africa and Eurasia. And this image comes from those wars. It's the rock-hewn church of St. George at Lalibela in Ethiopia, which was completed right about 1200 CE. But during this time, wars took place in Iberia with the Reconquista by Christians from the north fighting their way south. The parts of the Crusades that are best known with the fighting in Palestine, Syria, Lebanon, and more wars moving down to the region that's shown here. So I've got another copy of this map showing Africa and Eurasia, and want to emphasize that this period of religious struggle went on all along the dotted line there. So Saladin, the great warrior for the Muslim cause, sent his brother to Yemen to seize control there, not just to expand the realm, but to challenge the Christians across the Red Sea on the Ethiopian side. So these wars died down over a period of time, but what among the things that one can emphasize is that there were Christians and Muslims, people of all colors, on both sides of these wars. It's a very complicated sort of interaction, but the lesson that I'm trying to draw out of it is the interaction in particular. Oh yeah, there was one reference to race down there at the bottom, and that is to reminder that in these days, I mean, people were obviously all the different colors that we are nowadays, but the ways that people thought about race in those days were determined more by religious affiliation and clothing and other sorts of ways of categorizing people. To remind you that we do tend to categorize, but our patterns of categorization change from time to time. Here's our first really direct reference to enslavement. This is a picture of a Yemeni slave market and another of these roles that's played certainly by Africans in enslavement who have labored not just at home on the continent, but to all the directions that they've been carried. And yet the labor in some cases was that of the warrior. So the statue on the left is that which was built at Magdeburg Cathedral in the 13th century by the Hohenstaufen monarchy, seeking really to establish diplomatic ties with Egypt and Africa generally. And they brought up the case of Saint Maurice, who had been a third century Roman warrior who who had converted to Christianity and was martyred for failure, for reluctance to give it up. In any case, the celebration of St. Maurice was carried on through Central Europe in this period and for some centuries after that. And then my other image here comes from India in the 16th century. This is a retelling of the story of Alexander the Great. This is the Zanjis and Darab Dhul-Qarnayn is the great hero. He's always carrying on wars with the Zanjis, and the story ends up with him being reconciled at the end. But what I'm suggesting is that the pattern of the placement and the roles of people of African origin, either in the Muslim world or in the Christian world, were pretty much the same roles, and that it makes sense really just to think of the far diaspora, those areas further into Europe and Asia, as having a commonly shared sort of pattern for the small but important numbers of people who came from sub-Saharan Africa there. Well, in Africa, the notion of kingship was able to develop considerably, and here is an example from West Africa, from Ife in Nigeria, and from Central Africa in Congo. And where there's kings, there's queens. So this is a portrait of the Queen of Sheba that was made for the court of Charles IV of Bohemia up until the late 14th century. And another bit of iconography that showed up in Italy in the late 15th, early 16th century was the presentation of the three kings in the Christian Nativity, with one of them being African referring to a phrase in the Bible. And it's worth emphasizing that for all of these, that these representations of the Africans are portraits of individuals. And so there were people who posed for those portraits. Whether they were free or slave is a different question. But this representation of people in the images of the time has some relationship to reality. Here are two more such images of women who were maidservants. And in each case, the women's really were maidservants. Isabella d'Este was a wealthy aristocratic woman who hired Andrea Mantegna, the famous painter, to do a portrait of her along with her maidservant, a woman who came probably from Senegambia, West Africa. But as Judith, the biblical character who had just killed Holofernes, the Assyrian general, and there they are, having separated his head from the rest of his body. But in any case, but these are, in addition to being stories about the past, those are also stories about the present there in Italy in 1495. Albrecht Dürer, the famous Flemish painter, did this portrait of a woman, Caterina, who would have been in the first generation, perhaps, of women arriving from Africa into the North Sea area. And to pick another role of people who rose up in society outside of Africa, I've called these scholars. Alexander de' Medici was a big leader in his family. Juan Latino became known especially because of his poetry, and Saint Benedict the Moor, a Catholic priest who raised to sainthood, there are any number of churches named after him nowadays. And Ahmad Baba was grew up in Timbuktu, but spent much of his life in Morocco and is known for writing critical legal texts reaffirming opposition to the enslavement of black people who were already Muslim. And a few more examples, the one on the left, presumably from Iran, and that on the right from India, of servants, but servants at a high level, in each case going with their master on a hunt. What I've called a turn for the worse here is the collapse of what was the largest state yet to be established in sub-Saharan Africa, the Songhai Empire, which occupied the whole of the middle and upper Niger River Valley. But it was defeated by a Moroccan invasion in 1591 and collapsed, did not reorganize itself. This is also the time when the Ottoman Empire has expanded to take over almost the entire Mediterranean. In any case, following this time, the fate of Africa, and especially Western Africa in international relations, came to be dominated by enslavement. So I've identified the period from 1600 to 1800 as a time where the principal theme was that of survival of African diaspora communities, and time of considerable turmoil on the continent as the enslavement took place. So one of the divisions that I've chosen to emphasize was that between the elites, the rulers, the slave catchers and the slave owners, on the one hand, represented on your left, and those communities that chose to do everything they could to escape enslavement, and whose ideas really emphasized egalitarianism and an opposition to social hierarchy, so that the Nimba mask and the Gribo mask, these are both from the area along the coast of Guinea and Sierra Leone, are really references to the earth and the earth mother and renewal of society. And they're a bit more abstract, whereas the references on the left from the kingdom of Dahomey and of Asante, both states involved ultimately very actively in enslavement, emphasize hierarchy and power, and in some ways are more realistic in their, that is to say, identifying people as people rather than in the abstract way of the Griot mask. So this division in African societies and division actually in artwork, in representation, came out of this social division that was taking place as enslavement spread throughout the continent. The middle passage, the carrying of some 10 to 12 million people across the Atlantic in the period from just after 1500 right up until 1850 is in a sense the best known, the worst reputed, and a horrific long chapter in human history. Something on the order of 1.5 million people lost their lives in the course of the voyage. And others lost their lives on the way to being put on the ships. And those who made it to the New World did what they could to get through. So here we have already by the 1640s a major sugar plantation in Pernambuco in northeastern Brazil, with the whip there as a reminder. And at the same time, there were opportunities for a little rest and recuperation. The reproduction on the painting isn't perfect, but here we notice a typical African three-piece band, two drummers, and the third musician playing a stringed instrument, and dances of sorts that are related to the dances from today. So people, though they weren't able to bring anything with them, were able to reproduce their cultural outlook in the Americas. And at the same time, well, continuing, because enslavement from Africa into the Middle East region and to South Asia had been going on for some time, but it expanded, especially in the late 18th century. And on the other hand, there were no shortage of free people of African ancestry in the Indian Ocean. So I've highlighted here the city. The city is a term that generally refers to people from the Swahili coast, so Kenya and Tanzania. But these were folks who took this this island of Janjira. It's not too far from Mumbai, and used it as the headquarters of a fleet. So they were very strong and effective merchants, and especially warriors, sometimes allied with the Mughal state, and held out there from the 1490s to the 1740s when the British finally chased them out. On the other hand, enslavement also led people to work as domestics in Egypt and in Anatolia and in Iran and in India, and also as plantation laborers in various places in those same regions. Now, within this period from 1600 to 1800, there's a kind of a turn that takes place right in the late 17th century, where the system of slavery on the one hand has expanded, and on the other hand, where those people who were enslaved were finding ways to get on their feet, finding ways to gain freedom, finding ways to build economic and even political communities. And so there's a crackdown that happens, especially known through the Code Noir imposed by the French government in 1685, which made emancipation or manumission much harder and generally tightened up the screws on people in slavery throughout the French realm. Now, this is normally done just as a European story without looking beyond that. But at the same moment, and across the Straits of Gibraltar, Mulay Ismail, the king of Morocco, who had a long reign, almost as long as that of Louis XIV, chose to build an army to protect himself by taking hold of, really enslaving, the black population of Morocco. These were people who were already in Morocco, free Muslims, but nonetheless were simply made into the army. There were certain privileges that went with it, and on the other hand, it's not what the people themselves had in mind. Now, the trick here is that Mulay Ismail's mother was born in the Western Sudan. All right, so he had his plenty of African ancestry on one side of the family, and on the other hand, he was a descendant of the Prophet from the other side of the family. Mulay Ismail had long debates with the religious scholars basically imposed his vision on them that under these circumstances it was all right to enslave these people. He even sent a great dossier defending his actions off to Egypt, to Al-Azhar, to ask the scholars there for approbation of his policy. No really strong answer came back, but according to the law, you would have expected the scholars at Al-Azhar to say, you can't do this. But it was an implicit approval. And so the message that I get out of this, at least, is that both for Christians and for Muslims, the formerly racial prejudice and hierarchy setting people of sub-Saharan African ancestry lower was not something inherited from the ages, but was something that was built in, especially by political decisions at a certain point, and that point was shared on both sides of the Mediterranean. In any case, this is an issue that's discussed and needs much more discussion throughout the Islamic world. But my position, at least, is that racial discrimination did develop in the course of the long centuries of slave trade and developed in with a timing not much different at all from that in the Christian world. But this is a photo of a horse trainer in Istanbul. It's just a nice image. Now we can come back to the point that if you think of the development of the literate traditions, of the intellectual traditions amongst Africans and people of African descent, then Europe has a particularly important role to play. These three people I've picked out here, Abraham Hannibal, who was in Russia, Olaude Equiano, who was in England, and the Chevalier de Saint-Georges, who was born in Haiti and grew up in England. These are examples of people who've given a lot of inspiration to later generations. And it's not written up so well for the Islamic world, but there were equivalent folks of sub-Saharan African ancestry who rose high in their societies wherever they were. This period from 1600 to 1800 comes to an end with the Haitian Revolution. So in the course of the revolution in France that overthrew the monarchy, that changed the old regime flag to the red, white, and blue, or blue, white, and red, I should say, of the tricolor, led in Haiti to a rebellion of the slaves, the largest successful rebellion of slaves any place. And when, after another 10 years of fighting, they declared the independent republic or republic and monarchy of Haiti, the flag was the same as the French flag, but with the white stripe we removed. So we enter the 19th century, a time dominated by a century-long campaign for emancipation. So this is emancipation of slaves, but if you look throughout the world, you realize there is emancipation of serfs during this same time. There's a big campaign for emancipation of women and campaign for emancipation of wage slaves. This image is too complicated, but what I'll just say is that it's an attempt to represent the changing sizes of the population, whose population was growing and whose was not. So the African population was not growing at the time when the Asian population was growing. And then the changing numbers of people enslaved and free within Africa and elsewhere. For Africa, it's probably about 1860 when the largest number of people were in slavery. And probably for the world as a whole, 1860 is the time when the largest number of people were enslaved. And then by 1900, most everyone was free, although a lot of people in sub-Saharan Africa were not. These are images reflecting the continuing enslavement during the 19th century. That's a very skillfully carved ivory tusk, that shows the chains of the people who are pictured here. Emancipation took place bit by bit across the 19th century. Reminder that Mexico freed its slaves well before the United States, for instance, and a reminder that in Africa, as in the Middle East, emancipation of slavery took place not through a single American or British style emancipation where everyone's free at once, but through individual manumissions over a long period of time. So these are 19th century images of the young man on the left is certainly in slavery. The Nubian woman in Anatolia in early 19th century might well be a free person. Still in the 19th century, free communities of color, people who were free as individuals or communities where slavery had ended, had opportunities to build up education, to assert political rights, to open businesses, to move to where they wanted. These were movements that were taking place, in this case, in Venezuela, in Jamaica, and with Edward Blyden, who grew up in the Caribbean, in Liberia and Sierra Leone. These stories are I think, equivalent stories for North America and the Middle East, or North Africa and the Middle East. They're not told as well yet. This is a reminder of the mixing and the different types of mixing that have been taking place all along, but I just give some 19th century illustrations to distinguish biological mixing of people from different ancestry, cultural mixing. So that image there from the French Antilles is from both French forms of dress and West African forms of dress. And then social mixing, just hanging out at an English pub. Again, in the 19th century, and most easily documented in Europe, people of African ancestry, sometimes Afro-European ancestry, who become leading cultural figures in literature and music. But with the end of the century, the European powers begin expanding once again, taking over new territories, and this is also a time when formal racial ideology develops. So Paul Broca, there's an area of the brain named after him for all he took. He had just lots of skulls and explored lots of brains, but convinced himself for sure that brains of black people were smaller and a different color than the brains of other folks. So a more explicit sort of racial discrimination shows up in the late 19th century. And then the colonial conquest of so much of the world takes place, but over a long period of time. You know, you can use Algeria as an example for an expansion of colonial conquest in Africa, but you can also use it as a point for expansion of colonial conquest in the Arab world. In both cases, this conquest went on for a full century, up to 1920 it took before the British and the French took over Syria, Lebanon, and Jordan. And then one thing to think about in this is for those people of sub-Saharan ancestry in North Africa, Middle East, there are minority populations under a colonial system. And I think you'll find it interesting to compare their situation with those of the black populations of Spanish, especially Latin America. In Brazil, the black population is so big, but even there, point is that the identity of people there is not especially African, and yet there is the racial discrimination and the hierarchy and the effort of minority populations to gain rights within regions that are just getting out of colonization. And I think that a careful work would show remarkable parallels between the lives of black communities in the Middle East and North Africa and those in South America. So from 1900 to 1960, for really black communities around the world, citizenship was the issue on the table. Because it is remarkable that in 1900, there are almost no black people in political power any place, right? In Africa, all of the kings had been made chiefs and administrators within the European administration. In the Americas, those blacks who had risen to political power were out. So that's a real low point, and it's punctuated by the high point in white supremacy. So there's Cecil Rhodes in his triumphant mode as portrayed by a cartoonist. And then the other portrayal there comes from North America, from the US. And it's a reminder that for black men held in subordinate position, one important way up was through military service. And so this is a case of an African-American newspaper supporting the participation of black men in the World War I effort in the US. But the same story is told again all over Africa in World War I, and similar stories were told in Latin America in earlier times. And now we're back to thinking of Moulay Ismail and his army in Morocco. But at this time period, despite the weak political position and the weak position in intellectual terms of people of African descent, these extraordinary cultural developments took place. So jazz music is easiest for Americans to talk about, but samba and calypso and Afro-Cuban music are types of cultural presentation that develop and enable these communities to get on their feet and establish allies. And so here's an interesting example of the same pattern in East Africa and the Indian Ocean. Sidi Binti Saad started singing late in life. She was in her mid-30s once she started work at it. But she began singing in a Taarab style in Swahili initially, and then became a recording star. She went to Bombay, where the recording studios were, and she sang in Arabic and Hindi as well as Swahili. And she's contemporaneous with Bessie Smith. I don't know if the comparisons go any further than that. The labor movements and this sort of really masculine presentation that goes for the 1920s and 30s are shown here for South America, but parallel stories can be told for the African continent and for North America. And by the time we get to the 1950s, the black communities, so politically weak at the beginning of the century, now have philosophers and political activists of extraordinary strength. So Frantz Fanon grew up in Martinique, trained as a doctor in France, went to Algeria as a psychiatrist, switched sides, and ended up being the editor of the newspaper for the Algerian National Liberation Front. So the remarkable thing then is that in this short period of time in the 1960s, black people had political leaders again. So that's the story of civil rights in North America. It's a story of independence in Africa and of stronger citizenship rights in many other countries. Ghana normally gets attention as the first sub-Saharan African country to gain independence, but actually it was Sudan. The elected government didn't last long. General Aboud took over in 1958. But the Sudanese role is important. This book was written by Carolina Maria de Jesus. She's a literate but impoverished woman in Sao Paulo, who wrote a diary that was published and sold all over the world to indicate what urban poverty was like or was becoming like. And that was sort of the hint of the problems for the next period. So a struggle from the 1960s to 2004, equality, having gained citizenship. These are various examples of the upside of independence and then the downside of independence, because Angola had this long war. There's independence of South Yemen. This is a later stamp celebrating it. The growth of cities, and that makes me think of, you know, the growth of black populations in cities in the Middle East and North Africa. So Rabat and Basra come to mind. Kind of a sudden flow of a lot of Nobel Prizes going especially for peace, but also especially for literature, to people of African descent. And in the same period, the cultural production that had shown up in earlier time periods as so central to political advance now became even increased in popularity and made a wealthy man out of Taboulay, Rochereau, who's shown here, and of Michael Jackson. The Gnawa musicians of Morocco didn't get wealthy, but they play an important part in Moroccan culture. Well, and then the problems of this era are those of continuing and, in a sense, growing inequality. Now a black elite can form. We see it in Washington here. That the pictures of New Orleans, of course, are 2005 and Katrina. And now I'm zipping into my last period, which begins right about 2000, and in which we can say that there now exists a new African diaspora, that African migration from the continent pretty much stopped with the end of slave trade in about 1900. Wish it were earlier than that, but 1900 is when it pretty much ended. But after 1970, people who were all free, and many of whom were literate, began migrating again. And migrations of two sorts. On the one hand, professionals. So I was in Qatar, in Doha, last few days, and met with a surprising number of Sudanese academics, who work, academics and businessmen who work in Doha. These are representative of a new migration from Africa and an interconnection then of those who are in the old African diaspora going back generations and those who are in the new African diaspora just showing up. That's for the professional level, and on the other hand, there are also refugees at the level of poor people escaping a disaster and maybe running into another disaster. Well, what I want to emphasize here is a point that's been implicit all along, and that is for the people of African ancestry in the Middle East and North Africa, they have chosen to emphasize Muslim religion and Arab identity and to think of themselves not so much as part of the African diaspora. So the distinction between a migration and a diaspora is that, as I see it, of maintaining a steady consciousness of being tied and linked to the homeland. And so we can see the way in the United States where a consciousness of the African diaspora has grown stronger and stronger, and you can see in South America where a consciousness of the African diaspora started later, but during the 1990s became considerably stronger. That's not so much the case in this region. And my image of Toulouse is an interesting twist on this. This was these demonstrations in Toulouse and Paris at that time of people of North African origin who were French citizens, most of them in the suburbs, but getting nowhere with regard to jobs and so forth. And so they rebelled, and here's a picture of rebellion. But they were classified all this time as Arabs and North Africans. Well, fair enough, but no small portion of those Arabs and North Africans were Arabs and North Africans, also of sub-Saharan ancestry if you go back a few generations. Well, the answer is you get to choose your own identity at one level or not. Someone else can tell you what your identity is. And the choice that's made in this region is relatively clear. The point that I want to make is rather than ask the people with African identity, African ancestry, to change their identity, is nonetheless to make sure that we go back and look at the history. There's much more to be done on the history of people who settled here willingly or unwillingly from Africa. And so it's very interesting that in Qatar there is a proposal for a museum on slavery and its legacy that's being developed. I mention a book that addresses some of these issues considerably. Shuki Alhamel, who teaches in Arizona, wrote a book, Black Morocco, which focuses on the time of Moulay Ismail and the creation of that black army, has led to an interesting discussion in Morocco. And then the last point here is the illustration of this painting that was done by an English painter. I'm not certain whether the painting was done in America or in England, but Joe Ben Solomon, or Ayuba Suleiman Diallo is his actual name, were from Senegal, but who had been enslaved and then freed in the Americas. But that this painting was purchased by the Qatar Museums Authority as part of the policy of just museum building. But it's an interesting an example of a reinvestigation of the history of black involvement in this area. Well, there it is. I have this last image there, of which is the cover of my African diaspora book. This, the colorful one, is Sheba, it's called. It's by Romare Bearden, the African-American artist, and I thought was a nice illustration of the African diaspora over time. I've gone over time, but thank you very much for your patience.
I had a question because we actually had this discussion at work a few days ago, and we were speaking about slavery and who's responsible and such, and then one of my colleagues actually said, well, you know, it's Africans that took Africans to, you know, the colonizers, and then they are the ones who took them. So I think that person was implying that, in fact, Africans do bear a lot of responsibility for, you know, the transatlantic slave trade and such. And then I tried to think back about what I learned in school and about the fact that actually, you know, there was a lot of exploitation, and that the people who, the Africans who brought their fellow Africans to the colonizers, in fact, had no idea that, you know, they were actually going to be taken, you know, to the other end of the world, and a lot about the hardships that they would endure. So because my memory is a little bit rusty in this respect, I wanted to get your insights on that particular issue.
In teaching courses on African history, I've often done the device of asking people to adopt the roles of various participants in the slave trade, of those who were catching, of those who were caught, of those who were getting away, of European visitors in various roles. And it's an argument, and people can figure out what the differing roles are in this. There were lots of rumors circulating around the African continent about what happened to people once they were put on the boat. It was widely believed that they were consumed, cannibalized. Or another one was that they were ground up. Their bones were ground up for salt and things like that. So it was understood that this was a fearsome sort of destiny that people faced. There remain debates amongst the Africanist scholars as to how much slavery there was in Africa before the European slave merchants showed up. Now, this is dealing with the West Coast, right? In the East Coast, the slave trade grows at a longer, slower time period, but it's a similar sort of question. I'm amongst those who believe there was no economic reason for holding on to large numbers of slaves in sub-Saharan Africa centuries ago. Though by the 19th century, big men, would-be big men, had figured out ways to do it, and there was an expansion of slavery in the continent as the number of people being sent out of the continent declined. But if you think of the case of a group which is defending itself against the mercenaries who are coming after them, and if they succeed in catching the head guy who's been chasing and capturing slaves, what do? And often enough, what happens is the best solution was to sell that person into slavery. So you're caught in a system. Once the system has grown up, it was surrounding people every place. Nonetheless, there's much more results showing up about maroon communities of escaped slaves. So in some times, Islam was used in order to defend slaves, slavery, but in other cases, Islam was the basis by which people fought against enslavement. So it was a mess. The point, I think, is that slavery for those several centuries, for the 17th, 18th, and 19th century, was part of the history of us all. It was throughout the African continent. It was widespread in the Americas. It was widespread in Europe, in Asia. Not quite so widespread in Europe, although gypsies were enslaved in Eastern Europe. So the society as a whole relied on slavery, and then we mostly got out of it, but now we're finding we haven't totally got out of it, right? So there's contemporary individual level slavery, no longer supported by the state, but people can get away with it. It remains a problem.
You estimated the amount of enslaved individuals in the transatlantic slave trade as 1 to 1.2 million. And I've heard some estimations of even as much as like 400 million. So I was just curious as to what do you think about those estimations that are in the hundreds, and why do you select the 1 to 1.2 million? Why would some people say 400 million and you select 1.2?
We'll never get rid of all the discrepancies, but if you think of the way the problem is set up, you can see a lot of what's going on. The big debate, the one about whether it's 10 million or 30 million, that's about the number of people who got on the boats and went across the Atlantic, right? But then we have, in addition to that, the question, just thinking of the Atlantic side, how many people were displaced or lost their lives in the course of capture and movement towards a coast? So that certainly adds some. And then if you think about the number of people sent across the Sahara, and especially the number of people sent across the Indian Ocean in the 19th century, so to Madagascar and Mauritius and Reunion and to this region, certain number of people brought in, particularly as pearl divers and so forth, and then you think of the losses on the African continent, it gets quite large. You won't ever get me up to 400 million, but if you trace all of the loss and all of the damage, it can really get very high. Problem is, we don't have very specific records, but it's worth trying to estimate, and that's a certain amount of what I'm trying to do. There's a book I've been trying to get out for the last 20 years on this, but I may get it out in the next year or so.
Thank you. It's an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
I have two questions. One, you made a reference to Franz Fanon.
Yeah.
You said he switched sides. I didn't quite understand.
Oh, I didn't say which sides. He switched from an employee of the French state in a French psychiatric hospital to join with the Algerian revolutionaries in opposing French rule.
Thank you. Number two, I thought something else had occurred that I wasn't familiar with. And number two, you don't talk much about how the Africans who were brought to the Americas were disassociated, I guess that's the only word I can think of that's pleasant, from their heritage. I don't know about the diaspora to the Middle East, but in America there was a complete disassociation from anything African. So there wasn't a continuation of the culture. Now, the culture re-emerged, as you point out, in music and dance, some literature. But what about the devastating aspects of what enslavement meant? It meant a dehumanization, it meant a total rejection of what you represented prior to that transition. So I just wanted to ask you, are you paying much attention to the impact that that had?
Yeah, thank you for the point. We're looking at what I just said, and what I just said focused more on the ways in which people from the African descended communities figured out ways to compensate and move ahead. Rather than take so that's a long-term view, a bit sliding over what the problems were generation by generation of having siblings separated and just the amount of brutality in punishment, you know, demonstrably got worse during the 18th and 19th century. The owners just, you know, responded to rebellion with increasingly imaginative and ineffective words. I'll just take your point and go home and think about that one a bit.
The assimilation that takes place.
Yeah.
Most people think that's sufficient without understanding the long-term effects of the level of brutality that occurred, and that's all I'm asking.
Well, and we don't know enough about sociology and psychology to know how long the effects go on, right? Does it get passed quietly, unconsciously, two or three generations on down the line, where the punishment that's taken place in one time is passed on to others? We have indications that that might be the case. Another result of the system of enslavement was it changed family structures, right? And so single-parent families, to use the American phrase, were built into black communities by this system of slavery. And they remained there. Quite a different question is whether those families are necessarily inferior. You know, they might have been the best way to successfully bring up children in those circumstances. And now we find, if you look at Northern European marriage trends, you see that showing up in various other places. So in addition, so you wanted to emphasize the question of brutality and its effects. Yes. That and that's there's one sort of issue, and then the reputation of even the successful adjustments to slavery is another area of discussion for this. These are reasons why the discussion of slavery and enslavement don't go away. They don't go away because they turn out to be inescapable. They show up in lots of places. And I've been working on this sort of material for closing in on 40 years, and can remember the time when the fellow scholars and I looked at each other and saw, oh, well, this work is still going on. People are still interested in it. And we have a lot more work to do on it.
Well, thanks for the lecture. I have a question about when you date the emergence of a consciousness among people of African origin, let's call it a black consciousness, that would transcend perhaps the allegiances of tribe and ethnicity.
Yep.
Do you date that to the 19th century? Do you think it's a response to the pseudo-racial sciences that are emerging in Europe? Or can you give us some examples, some instances of something that can be called a genuine black consciousness in pre-modern times, so before the emergence of this pseudo-racial science?
Oh.
And especially in the Islamic world, because we do have examples, I think we can find instances of that in the non-Islamic world, but are there, in the Islamic world, does the universalist religion that is Islam in some way suppress, and you could probably say the same thing of Christianity, does it suppress the emergence of an explicitly black consciousness?
Yep, okay. Right, so I don't know if I'll be fast enough on examples, but the question is clear. Does the lack of a strong black consciousness movement of people in, see now, tricky, Islamic world. There's a whole bunch of sub-Saharan Africa in the Islamic world. Black consciousness is very strong there, okay? So we're talking about the Arab world, especially. I think what I would do in that case is turn to this parallel that I was offering with regard to Spanish America, where it might be just the social demographics. I mean, certainly there were rules in the Arab world by which people could assimilate. Right? Marriages between people of different colors could be recognized. Children could be freed. The sort of Christianity that slaves got was commonly very different from the Christianity that the masters got. I wonder whether that difference is in the type of Islam that black people and people who are not black got in the Islamic world, whether those were as big. So maybe that is a little bit because of the religion. But just because it's the Islamic world, I don't think we have to explain everything that happens in it through religion. In any case, what is happening now, bit by bit, is a step away from the basic denial in the Arab world of association with racially based slavery. That took place, but the number of scholars, of Muslim scholars based in the Middle East and North Africa who have taken this issue has been tiny until very recently. I could wish people had got around to it earlier, but my point is people are getting around to it nowadays, and this discussion is in a sense a part of that, that one can have that discussion in cross-religious environments. Those are some meanderings, but there's a thought. You have that. We're all done, it says here, that we... So thank you very much for...